You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Good evening, folks. Last night, remember all the talk about, I don't know how to find out. I can't find out. How do you find out? I can't go to Washington. Blah, 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 blah. Remember that last night? Within 20 minutes of the close of the broadcast last night, I knew everything there was to know about Independence Hall, including its United Nations status. All by myself, with no help, within 20 minutes, never went anywhere, never left my house. Had it all. And can document it officially with no problem whatsoever. So, for all you sheeple out there who think that's impossible, you know, I think you need to go back and take biology class again, human biology, because that thing you've been sitting on that resulted in your squashed brain is really your head, not your butt. And if you learn the proper anatomy, you'll learn where to sit so that your brain doesn't get squashed, so that you don't end up handicapped like that. Come on, people, get real.
Thank you.
Louis. Louis was born in New Orleans. Louis Armstrong. Didn't have anything. At a very young age, he went out on the street and danced for pennies and nickels. Somewhere along the line, he started to listen to the jazz groups and the bands and the clubs and decided he wanted to play an instrument. And somehow he came across an old trumpet and learned how to play it and played it on the street for pennies and nickels. He didn't complain. He didn't bet your mom and say,
"Oh, I'm just one lonely person. I don't know how to do it. I can't afford to hire a trumpet teacher. I can't afford to hire a dance instructor. I can't afford to pay somebody to teach me how to tap dance."
Where would the world be if he had? He just did it. What is wrong with all you people out there who have just absolutely had your brains sucked out of your head? All you know how to do is bitch and complain and whine and cry and make excuses and rationalize and just, I gotta tell you, it is sickening. I am so tired of hearing that crap. I just want to barf anytime I even remotely somebody think somebody's going to start with that refrain.
Well, I've never been held to those standards before. I don't know how to act.
Give me a break. This is a country founded by people and built by people who were doers, not whiners and complainers and have their hand out all the time and wishing somebody would do something for them. Give me a break. My God. Where did most of you people come from? And yes, unfortunately, includes most of the listeners to this broadcast. You are couch potato, whining, do nothing, never contribute to anything, never accomplish anything, just, you know, never had a chance, just one lonely human being. I don't have no money. I don't know how to do it. Nobody ever taught me that. I just don't have the time. I'm just trying to support my family. Blah! Blah! God, I'm so sick of that. Where did you come from? You can't possibly be Americans. None of your ancestors were that way. If they were, this country could never have even got off the ground. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. But when I talk to most people, that's what I hear. Well, I'd like to do something, but I don't know what to do, and I don't know how to do it, and I never learned how to do no research, and I don't have no money, and I don't have no time, and blah, 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 blah. Blah! Blah! Oh, just make me want to puke all over everything. And you think you're going to survive what's coming? With that kind of attitude? Do you call yourselves patriots? I don't think so. I don't think so. Mm-mm. No. This is just absolutely unsatisfactory. By any standards. Do you realize if some major power in this world just had the means to land a large number of troops on these shores with people with attitudes like that, that could take over this country in about 2 days. But fortunately, for all you do-nothings, there's at least 3.5% of us who aren't do-nothings and just by ourselves. Without your help, we'd be able to stop them. While you're complaining about all the conditions created by the fighting. Well, you're pissing and moaning and bitching because the trucks aren't coming and you couldn't buy a head of lettuce at the grocery store.
Save me.
I've discovered over the years that this is not the country I thought I was born into, and these are not the people that I thought were, you know, the great American people who were to inherit the promise of this nation. Nope, I don't know where they went. There's just a few of us left. Very few. Not very many. Not very many. Thank God we're here, though. Thank God we know what's what. Thanks God we know the history. Thank God we know what it means to be free and are willing to die for it if necessary. I don't know what's going to happen to all the rest of you. Flotsam and jetsam is what I call you. Flotsam and jetsam, washed back and forth upon the tides. You know, you don't have anything to propel yourself in any direction whatsoever. You're at the mercy of whatever's going on around you. Just helpless. Just floating along. You might walk up, wash up on the beach and dry out in the sun and wither away and rot. Or you might float around, get waterlogged, or you might get eaten by a fish, or run over by a boat, or just, you know, sink to the bottom. And but I'll tell you this, you don't have a damn bit of control over any of it. Because you're helpless. You can't think. You can't figure anything out. You can't do anything, support anything, contribute to anything. You can't get up off that couch. Oh, no, you don't have enough time. My goodness gracious. No money. No brains, no education, no nothing. You're just helpless little flotsam and jetsam just bobbing around on the waves. Wind blows you this way, and then the wind blows you that way, and the tide takes you this way, and the tide takes you that way, and some fish might eat you and swallow you and digest you and then pass you through, and then something else might come along and recycle you again, but you know, you ain't got no control over none of it. Well, I gotta tell you, there's gonna be a backlash to all this crap. It's coming. I can smell it. It's in the wind. I don't know when it was. A couple, 3 years ago, I did a broadcast warning the present administration that if they continue with their lies and their bullshit and their corruption and their treason, that there would be a backlash someday, somehow. I didn't know when or if it would ever occur, you know, within my lifetime, but I know that history goes in cycles. It really does. And you can see it if you're paying attention, and some of those cycles may occur in your lifetime. But there's a danger with these cycles, because if the pendulum swings real far to the left, the farther it swings, the angrier people become, and when it swings back to the other side, you have extreme reactions that are just as bad. Just as bad. The extreme reactions on either side are not good for anybody. But that's what happens, and I smell a backlash coming right now. Up until I began to smell this trend, Al Gore was a shoo-in. Democrats had it made. because this politically correct atmosphere was ruling. But all of a sudden, and it seems like it's just been within the last week or two, everything is changing. People are backlashing. The pendulum is swinging. And I can tell already it's going to go way to the other side. There's going to be bad consequences to this. It doesn't matter what power in the world has chosen Al Gore to be president of the United States. He doesn't have a prayer in hell now anymore. You see, once this process begins, it is radical in its nature. It is radical in its nature. I don't know what we're in store for, but things are going to change. Things are going to change. People are fed up with the lies, the corruption, the intentional deceptions, the spin in the news, the fact that you can go to prison for many years for cracking an eagle's egg, but it's okay to murder a human being in the womb. People are sick of this crap. They're fed up with it. Now, I'm not talking about you do nothing, don't find no time, can't contribute, don't know nothing, couch potato, never accomplished anything, never gonna accomplish anything, sit around, bitch, whine, piss, and moan all day. I ain't talking about you because you don't mean nothing in the scheme of things ever, anyhow, period. Boy, I bet that pisses you off, doesn't it? But it's true. Smack! Right upside your head. It's the truth. You're worthless. I'm talking about people who will do something. I'm talking about people who are active. I'm talking about people who care. I'm talking about people who will make a difference. They're on the move. And I'm telling you something like never before in the history of this country, the abortion issue is going to determine the outcome of this election. And guns. And a lot of other things. But there's going to be a backlash against the IRS that you never dreamed could ever happen. Socialists are in trouble. Big trouble. Up until recently, I had no idea this was going to happen. In fact, I didn't think it would happen, to tell you the truth. I looked out across this country and I saw a bunch of people just following. Just buying in to the bullshit in the media every day. Just buying it by the bucket load. As long as they were doing that, boy, there wasn't going to be... Whoa. No hope. But now I see it coming. There's a backlash coming, the likes of which nobody has seen for a long, long time. The pendulum is swinging. It means good news. And it means bad news. What the bad news is, I can't fathom right now. But when that pendulum swings all the way as far as it's going to go to the other side, bad things are going to happen. That's what happened in Germany when Hitler rose to power. The pendulum swung way over. That's what happened in Russia when the Bolshevik Revolution took place. The pendulum swung way over. Millions of people died. Millions. Not just a few, not just a couple of hundred, not just a few thousand, millions. And over the years, hundreds of millions. That's what happened when Mao Zedong took over China. The pendulum swung way over to the other side, and millions of people died. Millions, hundreds of millions. Now it's going to happen in this country. It's going to swing from the far left to the far right. Bet on it. Believe it, take it to the bank. Al Gore, you might as well you might as well retire and, you know, go find yourself a little survival cabin somewhere, because you're going to need it. It's over. I've been sensing something in the wind for the last couple of weeks. Now I know it's happening. I know it's happening. And before you jump up and go skidding around doing your little dance of victory, remember that I told you this. When the pendulum swings, if it goes all the way over to the extreme on the opposite side, it's no victory for anyone. It bodes bad tidings for all. You see, somehow we've got to make that pendulum stay in the middle and swing just a little bit to either side and never go extreme to either side. That's what the founders tried to do. But there's no balance of power anymore. Whoever takes charge in Washington, D.C., I'm telling you right now, the executive branch rules. And while somebody like Bill Clinton is transparent as cellophane on a pack of cigarettes, somebody like George Bush Jr. is not. And you won't know what this guy's up to. So all bets off are off now. Even Democrats are bailing out. Longtime socialists are bailing out. I've been doing some real deep research on what's happening across this country, and I'm telling you right now, the pendulum is swinging. Gore's boat is sinking. Clinton's boat has already sunk. It's over. They blew it. They screwed the pooch. And there ain't going to be no puppies. It's all over. And this is not going to be fun. Study the history of the Bush family, in particular, Georgie Jr.'s father. His association with the CIA, the secret societies, his participation in the invasion, or I should say the fiasco of the Bay of Pigs. His supervision of the first large-scale drug smuggling into this country when he was president and CEO of Zapata Oil. His participation in the Nicaraguan debacle. El Salvador, lots of other things. His unilateral invasion of the country of Panama to arrest its leader. And since Manuel Noriega has been arrested, there's more drug money and more drugs flowing through the nation of Panama than ever in history. What's coming is not going to be good. But I'm telling you right now, every prediction I ever made about Al Gore becoming president based upon the powers that be determining that he was going to be president, and the fact that most of the American sheeple were following blindly whatever this treasonous Clintonista group in Washington, D.C. told them to do, it doesn't apply anymore. See, when I did that show on the When the Pendulum Swings, when I did that broadcast and told you about a backlash, when this kind of thing occurs in history, powerful people don't have control over it. Oh, yeah, they might be able to rig the vote count. They might be able to do lots of things, but it's not going to stop that pendulum once it starts to swing. It can't be stopped. Once it starts, it's going. Anything that's in its way will be swept aside. And it's going. It is going. The Million Mom March only had about 100,000 moms. Max. If you really want to give them some slack and give them some numbers that they don't even deserve and weren't there, 150,000. Max. Maximum. No more than that. And anybody can figure that out. It's real easy. Remember when Louis Farrakhan had his Million Man March? Well, they had just a little over a million, probably. According to the official count of those who claim they know how to count crowds. If you take the photographs of the Million Man March and compare them to the photographs of the Million Mom March, 100,000 max. We'll give them 150,000 max. All this media hype about how effective they are and how they're going to change the gun laws, all bullshit. Ain't going to happen. Ain't going to happen. In fact, what I smell in the wind is gun laws are going to be repealed all across this country. The pendulum is swinging. Nothing's going to stop it. It's moving. It's already moving. Don't get all excited about it. It does not bode good for any of us. You may think so for a while, but the farther it swings, the worse things will get. Remember how happy people were when Hitler took over Germany? Finally, things were going to get better. Their economy was going to get better, and it did. He was going to get the crime off the streets, and he did. Lots of things were going to happen, and they did. And then, look what happened. that's my kind of music. That's the kind of music I love. I can listen to that for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours. Now let me tell you what I found out about Independence Hall, since I've got all the other stuff off my mind. You needed to know that. It's important. You can... I think some of you may be sensing that also. It's all over for the Clintonistas. It's all over for Gore. It's over for the Democrat Party. Finished. They're finished. I'm not kidding you at all. They're finished. Independence Hall has been declared a World Heritage Site. It is not a biosphere, as the first caller thought. Or actually was passing on his brand of the latest rumor. It has been designated a World Heritage Site. It is not in the control of the United Nations. It is not owned by the United Nations. It is owned by the United States government and controlled by the Park Service, the National Park Service. A World Heritage Site, unlike a United Nations biosphere, is merely a designation of a historical site that has contributed to the progress of humanity. A United Nations biosphere, on the other hand, is in the control of the United Nations. And I got an email today, I had to laugh at that. Somebody said, and you shouldn't say that on the air, because nobody's going to go to war over Independence Hall. No, it's never going to happen, you shouldn't say that. I never said they were, I beg your pardon. I said it's grounds. If it were actually turned over to the United States Nations, if it were turned over to the United Nations, owned and controlled by the United Nations, it would be grounds to go to war all by itself. I think if you play the tape back, you'll never find that I ever said that people would go to war over it. However, if this backlash continues and the pendulum continues to swing, we might find ourselves at war a lot quicker than what you thought or what you ever dreamed, and we might go to war for much less than what you think we might. That's what happens when the pendulum swings. So that's the whole story of the UN biosphere thing. It's not. Wasn't. And can't be. It's not a biosphere to start with. It's a World Heritage Site. Okay? That means they put up a plaque, and it's listed with the United Nations and in the Registry of World Heritage Sites as a place where something happened that contributed to the evolution of humankind. And I don't mean evolution like the evolutionists mean it. I mean societal evolution. Toward prosperity and peace and better conditions for humanity. Okay? So that's what that's all about. Now, understand that I found that information within 20 minutes of closing out this broadcast. And that's counting the time I went in and made myself another glass of iced tea. That's counting the time it took the computer to boot up. Counting the time, you know, that I waited for the search to go all over the internet and come back with what I needed. Punch on the pages that I wanted and watch them come up and then proceed to find the ones that truthfully and honestly documented what I was looking for. I could have done the same thing on the television, on the telephone during normal working hours on the East Coast, simply by calling various agencies of the United Nations, and then when I found what I wanted, requesting the proper documentation be sent to me in the mail. You all could do the same thing, too. The other day, one of our longtime listeners, who should have known better, called me on the phone. Bill, I just heard that they're up some northern state, the feds have invaded the state, and it's a big biological warfare thing. Terrorist attack and all that kind of stuff. I said, I don't think so. Well, that's what I'm hearing all over shortwave. I said, why didn't you find out what the truth was before you called me? Well, this is what everybody says is happening. I said, well, that's not the truth. Because if it was really happening, I would have known about it before you called. That's the way my real operatives keep me informed. I said, now, listen to me carefully. Call that city. Call the county sheriff, the police chief, the chamber of commerce, or the mayor's office. Find out what the truth is. Well, I heard it on the radio in this station and that station, and you know, I'll call those stations back and I'll tell them what you said. I said, no. No. You call and find out what the truth is. Well, I don't really want to do that because... I said, why not? If they don't want to talk to you, what are they going to do? Hang up on you? Does that hurt? No. Are they going to get angry with you and yell at you on the phone? Well, they might do that. Well, is that going to hurt you? No. Oh, what can they possibly do to hurt you? Why are you so afraid to call at the source and find out the truth of what's happening?
I don't know.
But he didn't want to do it. Nobody ever wants to do it. Biggest bunch of bullshit cowards I've ever seen in this country today. Afraid to even make a phone call to find out if something's true or not. They'd rather pass on the rumors and help bring down the country than just make a couple of phone calls and find out what's true and what's not. It's disgusting. So finally, I talked him into it and hung up, and about a half hour later, he called me back and says, you were right, nothing is happening up there. Nothing at all. Just local hospital and local police having a little emergency drill. Almost every city in the country does that every once in a while. Fire departments and police and emergency rooms at hospitals practice, you know, some kind of disaster happened, and they see how well they're prepared to handle it. Meantime, on shortwave radio, it was flying around the country that the feds had invaded the state and were with black helicopters and troops were landing and they were having biological terrorist attack drills and it wasn't supposed to happen in that state and everybody in the state is really angry and blah 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 blah. Know what I mean, Vern? Hey, Vern. Know what I mean, Vern? I've been trying to teach you people. We're into our ninth year now. Many of you have been with this broadcast all that time, and while you've learned some things, you haven't learned a whole hell of a lot. Sometimes it just makes me feel like all my efforts have been futile, wasted, worthless. Ever get that feeling? Just work your butt off, do everything you can, and then find out that it didn't make a damn bit of difference at all. Well, you see, when all this stuff continues to go on, that's the feeling I get. And it's disgusting. Good evening, you're on the air.
Oh, hi, Mr. Cooper. That song you played, do you know what it means to miss New Orleans?
Yep.
I haven't heard that in a while, although I have it on some records. And I love the New Orleans music. And you remember the Dukes of Dixieland, Pete Fountain, and Al Hurt? They were all great musicians. They were all conservatory trained.
Oh, yeah, I've got a lot of their records.
Yeah.
On vinyl.
But they weren't, they didn't play the real New Orleans jazz. I'm not trying to demean what they did. They were
they played pop jazz.
Right. They didn't play the real New Orleans music.
No, they were interested in selling records.
Right.
The real New Orleans music came off the street.
Yes.
Came off the street, into the clubs, out of the clubs, into the street, out of the street, back into the clubs. I mean, it's just incredible.
And I was very fortunate to meet some of the real, authentic musicians, such as George Lewis and Ray Burke. And they were the unsung heroes, and they never received the recognition that they should have received.
How about old Professor Longhair?
Professor Longhair, yeah, I've heard of him.
Well, listen to him again.
Okay, I will.
Here he comes.
Okay, thanks.
Professor Longhair.
Okay, thanks a lot, Bill.
You don't know about New Orleans jazz. This is the real thing. Henry Roland Byrd. He was known as Professor Longhair. He was the biggest draw in New Orleans for the greatest number of years of any musician who ever played in New Orleans. And they called him Professor Longhair. Really, truly a phenomenon. Came off the street. Literally, walked in off the street, sat down at a piano, when the normal piano player was taking a break and started playing. The owner of the club fired the band and hired him. That same minute. Incredible story. Literally walked him off the street. He was a street guy, card player. Part-time this, part-time that. Taught himself to play the piano. That was him, Whistler. Incredible musician. Like Louis Armstrong, taught himself. Walked in right off the street. Incredible. You didn't see him sitting around saying, I don't have this, can't do it, don't have enough time, don't have enough money, can't end that. Gimme. If you find the most successful people, folks, you'll find they don't have anything that you don't have. When they started, they didn't have anything more than you have. They just had a dream. They decided that they were going to reach it no matter what. And they did it. And they didn't do it by whining and crying and bitching and moaning and complaining. And gimme, always have their hand out looking for something for free. No, you'll find they all worked hard, and they work hard all their life. Even when they make it, they still keep working hard. Work hard, right up to the day they die. They know what it's all about. They also know that whining and bitching and complaining and sitting on the couch and moaning and groaning and looking for something for free all the time will make you sick. And good, honest work and a positive outlook will make you feel good. And will make you healthy. It's true. How else could Frank Sinatra have drank 2 bottles of Jack Daniels almost every day of his life and lived to be as old as he lived to be and done all that he did? Right?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how to do that.
Disgusting. Disgusting. And you know what you don't know about how you are? Is that you're not fooling anybody. Your wife, your children, your uncles and aunts, brothers, sisters, mothers and fathers. They're all watching you. They can see you. They know what you are. They know it, man. You're not hiding anything from anybody. And it's just going to make you and them and everybody miserable. So they all just, you know, walk away from you. Which they will do eventually if you don't change your ways. Ain't that sad? Yeah, it is. Get into some music. Get fired up. Get positive. If I didn't have a positive outlook, I wouldn't be doing this as many years as I've done it. If I didn't think that those of us who are doers and thinkers and shapers and molders and creators and all of those things, if I didn't think that we could affect change for the better, I wouldn't waste my time, because I'm not a time waster. I'm a doer. And I devote my time to things that I believe can be accomplished. No matter how long it takes, I don't give up either. Some things may take time way beyond my lifetime that I'm working on and contributing to now that I may never see the culmination or the bringing to fruit of my labor, but it will happen. And part of the reason it will happen is because I've done what I've done and contributed what I've contributed toward that goal that somebody at some future date after I'm dead will finish. and most of you can't even get started on something that you could finish in 10 minutes. I laugh about it, but it's not funny. It's pathetic. It's just absolutely tragic. It is heartbreaking. Pathetic. Lots of other things I could call it. For those of you in the Round Valley who are listening, if anybody is still listening, I would have turned off this broadcast 15 minutes ago. Because I'm not talking to me, and I wouldn't have wanted to listen to it if you know, I wasn't talking to me. But if you're still listening in the Round Valley, immediately following this broadcast, there will be a special presentation of Death and Taxes. It's the long version, director's cut. It's the true story of what really happened to Gordon Call. Now, many of you may not even know who Gordon Call is, and it's all the more reason to watch Round Valley Television Channel 15 immediately following this broadcast. It's about almost 2 hours long. I'd say about 7 minutes short of 2 hours long. Death and Taxes. It's the true story of what really happened to Gordon Call. And so if you're in the Round Valley, tune in to Channel 15, Round Valley Television. And I mean, is you're right at the top of the hour, at 8 p.m., that documentary will begin. That'll open your eyes. Oh, boy, I guarantee that'll open your eyes. You remember, some of you, that we had two of the police officers who were involved in the shooting with Gordon Call and his son, Yuri. And these are two police officers. One was the chief of police of Medina, where this incident took place. They were guests on this broadcast. Both of them said that the feds had lied to everybody, fooled everybody, and that the whole thing should never have happened. And that Gordon Call and his family were just defending themselves. And they lost their whole careers over it, because the feds used them as a scapegoat. Feds are nasty people. Nasty. Disgusting. Nazi, jackbooted, Gestapo, corrupt, stinking, rotten, constitution-killing thugs. It's true, folks. Unfortunately, it's true. If you watch Death and Taxes tonight on Channel 15, Round Valley Television, you're going to find that out. Once again... Now, we're not doing this to make the feds look bad. We're doing this so that you'll learn what the truth is. Because they got everybody snowed. I mean, totally snowed. You just better hope they never show up at your house, day or night, ever. Because if they ever do, they will destroy your life. Whether you're innocent or guilty makes no difference. They will destroy your life. They will destroy your house. They will confiscate every bit of property and money and bank account and car and RV and cabin, or your cats and dogs, they'll kill them right on the spot. They'll take your children away from you and put them in foster homes and destroy their lives. And you'll rot in prison for the rest of your life. Whether you did it or not, doesn't make any difference to them. Ask any prosecutor who will tell you the truth. He's not interested in justice. He's interested in convicting you. He doesn't care if you're guilty or innocent. Once your case comes up before him, his career depends upon whether or not he convicts you. And he'll lie, he'll cheat. Police officers, federal agents, witnesses will be coached and taught how to lie. And they'll convict you. And they'll throw you in prison. And you'll rot there. And your lives will be destroyed forever. Good night, folks. God bless each and every single one of you. Good night, Annie Poo and Allison. I love you. they'll kill you. Dead.